For the next 7 years, the Knights found refuge with Pope Adrian VI. They settled in Italy and promptly began to build hospitals, lick their wounds, and reestablish the core of the order. And they began to look for a new home. Charles V of Spain finally offered them the island of Malta. He recognized that the Knights could be valuable allies in defending Europe as they had for so many years. Malta was not what they expected. It was barren and unappealing compared to their lush and fertile home on Rhodes. But the Knights were not in a position to reject any possibility for a new permanent location. After a visit by a delegation made up of Knights from each lang, they decided it would do. Although more difficult to fortify than Rhodes and lacking some of its charm, the island was, in fact, a perfect strategic base. Malta's openness would prove an excellent defense against sneak attack. And from here, they could continue their God-inspired purpose to keep the Turks from gaining total control of the Mediterranean and achieving their long-sought prize, the conquest of Rome. But the price Charles demanded in return for the island was unthinkable. The Knights were to swear allegiance to Spain, and for the French Knights, that was unacceptable. More importantly, it might force the Knights to break their long vow not to take sides in a war between two Christian nations. So after much internal debate, they brazenly rejected Charles's proposal, and in return, offered him the choice of either a holy mass in his name each year or the yearly gift of a royal falcon on All Saints' Day. Charles's answer was to take the falcon. The Knights set sail for Malta in 1530 and once again took up their duty as the foremost outpost standing between Christian Europe and the Turks of the Ottoman Empire. Suleiman was now obsessed with capturing the heart of Christendom. But the European princes continued to bicker with each other as they had through the centuries, rather than readying themselves for the coming onslaught. The Knights, however, wasted no time in preparing. Malta was a challenge, for it had little of the natural defenses of Rhodes, and the Knights no longer had the income they had once enjoyed. The world had changed in the 16th century, and the growth of Protestantism had severed many ties to their historic holdings in Europe. But the Knights had two vital resources left: the determination of their own brethren and the dedication of one of their most illustrious Grand Masters, Frau Jean de Lavalette. When only 28 years of age, he had lived through the carnage at Rhodes, so he knew well what kind of threat they now faced. He began immediately to make the island as secure as possible. But with the order's usual foresight, he had also taken steps to establish a secret enclave of Knights within Suleiman's own capital city of Constantinople. They provided him with a constant stream of reports. So when the Turks arrived on the morning of May 18, 1565, Lavalette already knew they were coming. More than 500 ships now faced the little island, filled with the fighting men of Islam, including the famed Janissaries, who, taken in infancy from Christian homes throughout the Turkish Empire, were trained as the Sultan's elite troops. Against them, Lavalette had 470 Knights, 1,600 Spanish and Italian mercenaries, and about 5,000 Maltese militia. The Turks began their assault on Fort San Elmo to neutralize the fortress and gain entry into the main harbors. For weeks, they bombarded San Elmo and eventually began to make assaults upon its walls. Each time, the Knights repulsed them. And each night, La Valette would send reinforcements across the harbor and withdraw the wounded to Birgu, where Fort San Angelo stood as the order's main bastion. But the arrival of the notorious corsair, Dragut, put an end to that. As leader of the Turkish force, he set out night patrols and cut off supplies to the beleaguered defenders of St. Elmo. Then he began to attack in earnest. The knights at St. Elmo knew from the beginning their role was critical. Spain was gathering its forces to support Malta, but it would take time. St. Elmo was the key to the defense of Birgu and the future of Malta, and in the minds of many, the future of Christendom itself. The night of June 23rd, on the eve of the Feast of St. John, the wounded and bloodied knights at St. Elmo and their supporters gathered for confession and communion. They knew tomorrow they would fulfill their vows once and for all. At dawn, they took their stations. At least two of them so critically wounded, they had to be carried to their position on the walls. Dragut made his final onslaught and was himself killed by artillery fire. But his troops swarmed over the fortress. The last battle took place in the doorway of the little chapel. St. Elmo was lost. Even the new commander of the Turkish troops was dismayed at the cost in lives and the prospect of now attacking Fort San Angelo. Chronicles report that he lamented, "What will the mother cost when the daughter has been purchased at so heavy a price?" To demoralize the defenders, he nailed some of the decapitated bodies of the captured knights to wooden crosses and floated them across the harbor. But the defenders of Fort St. Elmo had bought time for the island. For the next 2 months, the other forts would hold out, thanks to the desperate valor of the order and the courage of the Maltese. In support of the knights, the Maltese risked everything. There would be no surrender as at Rhodes. Finally, September 7th, as the defenders neared their last gasp, the Spanish fleet broke through the Turkish blockade and landed reinforcements. The feat threw panic into the Turks, who overestimated the Spanish strength. By the time the Muslim commander realized it, his troops were in complete retreat. The great Ottoman Empire had failed to take the little island of Malta. And the joy celebrated in the streets of Malta that night echoes down to us through the centuries. Even today, more than 400 years since the cannons roared and people died, the island still remembers its heroes who sacrificed all for their faith, their ideals, and for their home in the middle of the shining Mediterranean Sea. Each year, this festa, or Feast of St. John, is specifically dedicated to the Knights of Malta. Once again, the knights were victorious over their old enemies, the Turks. All the centuries of hardship and sacrifice seemed behind them. But history is never so forgiving.